In the headlines, Prime Minister Skerrit pledges to introduce changes to make the Citizenship by Investment program more competitive. A call for sustained commitment to achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and a Dominican pilot endorses plans for an international airport. I am Kenny Williams with the Channel 5 News. Details after this. First up, new administrative changes are coming for the Citizenship by Investment program as government seeks to make the country's citizenship more competitive. Prime Minister Roosevelt Skerrit announced on Monday that these improvements will be in response to an expected decline in revenue receipts from the CBI program in the future. He was at the time addressing a national consultation on development prospects for Dominica within the context of the CBI program.
Frankly speaking, I do not see the CBI going away entirely because there will always be a demand in the world for various reasons for citizens, global citizens, wanting a second citizenship. What we should expect in Dominica is that there will be fluctuations in the performance of the program.
Mr. Skerrit says government continues to restructure the CBI program and increase investments of CBI funds in order to yield returns which will grow the economy.
And with this non-tax, non-loan source of financing, we have a golden opportunity, if we work together, to ensure that we can see the kind of returns that we'd like to see. When, and we have to say when, because I prefer to prepare for the worst than to prepare for the best. So we're preparing for the worst case scenario, where there will be a dramatic drop in the marketplace. And this is why I have taken upon myself, as the Minister of Finance, Prime Minister, to go to the marketplace. And I just came from a four-city visit in 3 days, and met with about 15 of the top global service providers of the CBI, and to engage them in consultations. How are things? What do we need to do to enhance our program? And I will be rolling out, subject to the approval of the cabinet, some administrative changes to our program to ensure that our program can continue to be competitive and attractive in the industry.
Mr. Skerrit also pointed out that cabinet has prepared a white paper on the CBI program, which will be made available to the private sector to be reviewed. Meantime, a reminder that a reserve fund for the CBI program be set up and a proposal for hotel loans to be refinanced with CBI funds are among recommendations from a forum to explore financing development activities for Dominica.
Monday's consultation saw presentations from four panelists, including Director of Research at the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank, Karen Williams. Williams spoke about how government can use CBI funds as a tool for financing development, advising that the CBI revenue be used to create an enabling environment for the private sector.
For 2016, just to give an example, we estimated that without CBI funds, the country would have had a significant fiscal gap, a large deficit, roughly 11% of GDP. And without the CBI funds, higher debt levels would be required to carry out its development agenda, and probably lower growth would have resulted. There are, of course, risks to the program, political, reputational, and the ECCB advocates that the authority should maintain the integrity of the program and use the funds to clear arrears, pay down your debts, finance infrastructure, and productive sector investments, as well as establish a resiliency or vulnerability reserve fund in line with best international practices. Also, to be transparent and accountable with respect to the flows. And this actually is a decision of the 86th meeting of the Monetary Council from October 2016.
Meantime, economist McCarthy Marie thinks government should consider allocating CBI funds to help hoteliers with existing hotel loans.
The rates of interest that the owners of properties are paying is somewhere between as high as 10%. They refinance some down to 7.5 and 8%. But those rates of interest are inconsistent with the conditions of the tourism industry as it is now, and the expectation of how fast it will grow up till the end of this planning period for tourism in 2022.
Government introduced a $15 million loan facility for hoteliers at 3% interest rate last year to help them upgrade their facilities. However, it does not cover the refinancing of existing loans. Marie says old loans should also be relieved.
And I think it would be useful if the government would use about, I think the amount that's owed to the aid bank by the properties of a tourism portfolio for some $43 million to take some of the CBI money and help to refinance the loans at the rate of 3%. If the debt is not relieved, that means the possibility of a number of properties going out of business completely, or their plant deteriorating so much that they essentially it simply closes, not because the bank seizes you, but because you simply get no clients.
The Prime Minister says he intends on holding similar consultations on a quarterly basis. Ido Najan-Baptist, Channel 5 News.
In other news, a Dominican aircraft pilot and flight instructor is endorsing plans to build an international airport. Rainstar Luke has been involved in aviation since his childhood and is the subject of a documentary called Celebration of Flight. He sat down with Channel 5 News during a recent visit from the United States and said an international airport will significantly improve tourism.
My personal experience, I'm going to come from, speaking from not only myself but also my family, we experience great frustration from traveling Dominica to the United States. We have to go through either San Juan, Puerto Rico. We also have to go through maybe Antigua, Barbados, which is additional cost, and it's additional stress. And I think when we are looking at a young country, which is Dominica, been independent since 1978, in order to move forward, we have to invest heavily in our infrastructure in aviation. The world is changing. And of course, if we want to be competitive, which is what we want to do to maintain our stance in ecotourism, we have to invest in aviation.
He explained that Dominica is the only independent CARICOM member state without an international airport, while neighboring islands are investing in the improvement of their aviation infrastructure.
So we can see that a lot of islands are beginning to realize that the lack of investment is actually hurting their tourism industry, which affects jobs, it affects an economy, bringing money in, and being able to develop a lot of their infrastructure. Part of international airports really help a country develop its economy. They're often in the Caribbean, we view international airports as a way of bringing tourists in, which is true. Yes, they do bring tourists in. But also we have to consider freight. That basically means that we can export large amounts of produce, whether it's our fruits and vegetables, to before our markets were only regional markets. Now we can ship products to US, Canada, Europe. And of course, if you think of a nonstop flight from Dominica to Europe, that's an 8-hour flight.
Luke further stated that an international airport provides the opportunity to create jobs for support services, including air traffic control, baggage handling, catering, and customer service. The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court is being described as a shining example of the possibilities of regional integration. Chief Justice of the ECSC, Dame Janice Pereira, addressed a special sitting of the High Court to observe 50 years of the Supreme Court's existence. The court was established in 1967 through the West Indies Statehood Supreme Court order at a time when the island colonies were taking charge of their own affairs.
The Eastern Caribbean Supreme Court is a unique institution with a peculiar history and structure. It is a regional organization within the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States and alongside organizations such as the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank, it exists, in my view, as a shining example of the possibilities of regional integration. It is a true regional structure, dispensing justice across its 9 member states and territories comprising the OECS.
The court consists of the High Court and Court of Appeals. The Chief Justice said while the court is faced with challenges, it has made considerable gains over 5 decades. 50th anniversary celebrations are expected to run until February 2018 under the theme, Celebrating the Past, Embracing the Future. Coming up, the couple who adopted Rosalie River on Earth Day on Saturday. That and more, next. Thanks for staying with us. CARICOM member states are now one step closer to achieving certain aspects of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal, SDGs. This as Dominica hosted the first meeting of the Technical Working Group on the Indicator Framework for the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development on Monday. Chief Statistician Prema Karat says collaboration among member states is key in realizing the SDGs.
The successful compilation of the SDGs demands collaboration and coordination as we realize it is cross-cutting among social, economic, and environmental issues. I must note the term coordination. Though great strides have been achieved in the coordinative process within our national statistical system, work must continue, particularly in the light of the SDGs. New data will be required. Therefore, new stakeholders must come on board. New data will be required. Therefore, new databases must be established, and we can go on. It is also imperative that the political will and support is needed for the realization of the SDGs.
Project Director for the Regional Statistics CARICOM Secretariat, Philemon Harrison, says member countries must remain committed to achieving the indicators of the SDGs.
In 2014, there was a statement that was endorsed by the SCCS as a standing committee. It was drafted by the advisory group, urging the international statistical community to push for a dual set of indicators, including a core set for CARICOM SIDS in terms of feasibility. When we saw these 200 plus indicators, maybe 250 plus indicators, you know, and already we were stressed in terms of our ability to meet the current demands, you know, from our users. We knew that we needed to start small and then maybe, you know, gradually gravitate to the entire set. And I have to say, even some of the larger countries, the more developed countries in the world, that is their view as well, that they cannot produce all these 200 plus indicators. The SDGs, as Prema also said, will be with us for a long time, and therefore the development of this TWG and its work is critical and timely in this regard, and of course for the SIDS framework, the Samoa pathway, which must be taken on board in its own right.
The Technical Working Group seminar ends on Wednesday. Economist Joshua Francis believes in order to place Dominica on a path towards addressing the issue of unemployment, the country would require 6 to 9% economic growth. Francis was among panelists at a panel discussion on the economy at Fort Young Hotel on Friday. That panel discussion was expected to bring together labor experts and business representatives to stimulate discussion around the topic, the state of the Dominica economy and a prognosis for the future. Francis told the small gathering data needs to be collected to determine the current status of youth unemployment.
When we have that type of economic growth, what is going to happen is there's going to be more money in circulation. With more money in circulation, it means that the private sector is going to benefit. So for example, as the fans on NASIF, if there's more money in circulation, it means they're going to have greater receipts. With more receipts, the need for additional employees is going to increase. Likewise, any other private investor. So not only the existing businesses will find it more lucrative and more fertile to employ more persons, but other persons will be encouraged to enter the market.
Francis says while he did not have figures for 2016 and 2017, the average per capita income or income per person has been in decline. He says that decline is an indication that the economy is not where it needs to be, noting that the issue of unemployment could not be adequately addressed without economic growth. He believes removing taxes on construction materials could help stimulate economic activity and help create employment.
We also believe that the private sector has to grow. So that is one of the mechanisms which can employ to grow the private sector. Because the public sector has been basically being the leader in Dominica in certain respects. The government of Dominica seem to focus a lot on public sector employment, but we are saying while we're employing people in the public sector, we need to place more emphasis on the private sector, because any country where the public sector is the main employer, it spells problems.
Next up, the qualification and graduation of 20 caregivers by the Premium Home and Residential Care Services is another significant step towards the establishment of a registry of trained caregivers of the elderly. The effort by the Council on Aging, along with other agencies, will ensure that every caregiver will be qualified and registered before engaging in rendering care at residential and private homes.
The establishment of such a database marks the beginning of standards that are to come on stream to regularize this care sector. In time to come, the Council will engage in consultations to promote necessary awareness among the relevant stakeholders and interested parties. As I end my short stint here, let me wholeheartedly congratulate this graduating class of 2016 and commend you on your tenacity and goodwill you exhibited during your training.
21 successful trainees in the care of the elderly received their certificates at a graduation ceremony on Saturday. The training was jointly organized by Premium Home and Residential Care Services, FARCS, with Dominica Council on Aging and the Martinique Association for the Care of the Aged. Most outstanding student of the class of 2016, Andrew Charles, will join graduates who will go on to Martinique for further training for a month.
The introduction of Mr. Franz Remy of AMDOR, Director and Promoter of Senior Citizens in Martinique, has promised us the additional training, work experience, and extension of the program, which will be held in Martinique. We, the graduates, are delighted to inform Mr. Remy that we are looking forward with much anticipation to continue with this leg of the program. We want to thank Mr. Remy and AMDOR, and we give him the assurances that everything we were taught here in the care of the elderly, we will take with us to Martinique as we await commencement in Martinique. Our willpower will be filled with love, commitment, and dedication to come to Martinique to work and cooperate with Mr. Remy and the staff of AMDOR in whatever institution we are placed for work experiences.
Maria Fontaine was named Student of the Year. Graduates were told even if their task was not easy, it was not a job or occupation and should be seen as a calling or vocation, not just for financial rewards, but for the love of humanity. The training covered not only elderly care, but child abuse and care of vulnerable children and adults. And to the environment now, Rosalie River has been formally adopted by a couple during a ceremony on Saturday. Beverly and Oscar formally received the adoption certificate as part of activities commemorating Earth Day.
We just need to do our part, cleaning it up and keeping it just as beautiful as they were when they were first here. So today, Beverly Dykel and Oscar are going to officially adopt this river. It's kind of a sign to others in the communities and all over Dominica that those 365 rivers need parents. We need to adopt them, keep them clean. We need our communities to come out and say, yes, we appreciate you, the Titiwi, the Viyu, all the wonderful fish that we eat every day, and all the great hikes that we have, all the waterfalls that we have. It's all here for us. But we have to keep it clean, because when we take and we throw our plastics and we throw our bags and we throw our bottles and our tin cans, we're destroying our planet.
The Rosalie River was blessed by Father Favalier as part of the ceremonies.
we pray that you will bless it once more today. Help us, Lord, to appreciate this gift, to cherish it and care for it, that you may never disfigure it by careless actions or pollution. May we keep its bank tidy and free from garbage. May it continue to flow gently and refresh us. And as we bathe in this water, may we remember the spiritual bath we have received when we were baptized by water and the Holy Spirit.
Those attending Saturday's Earth Day event in Rosalie also spent some time cleaning along the river edge. In June, a team from Trinidad's water company, WASA, is expected here to train individuals as water warriors.
We will train people to use their head, use their heart, use their hands, okay, for the health of the river and the health of the nation. And we'll also train them to be able to see what is happening around us, and then to judge and to act. So this will be the basic principle of the training program.
That's news. Sports, next. First up in sports, bottom-ranked Leeward Islands Hurricanes enjoyed a 10-wicket win in the most recent match against Guyana Jaguars in the WICB PCL Regional 4-Day Tournament. Highlights from that encounter, Guyana took first knock and made 187 all-outs with 33 from Leon Johnson and 30 from Kimo Paul. Raheem Cornwall picked up 6 for 68. In reply, Leewards were bowled out for 306. Jax Taylor scored 72 and Monson Hodge 70. Raymond Reefer took 6 for 74. Batting a second time, Guyana reached 143 all out. Set 25 to win, Leewards equaled the target in 9.1 overs with no wickets fallen. On the basketball scene, we can tell you that Joel McIntyre was an unstoppable force for Fast Cash Prowlers when they reminded Police Sports Club that the Premier League is no walk in the park to take a 36-point lead in a recent match of the DABA League. Final scores, Fast Cash Prowlers 89, Police Sports Club 53. Scoring for Prowlers, we had Joel McIntyre with a game high of 42 points, while Julian Isles Jr. added 14, Craig St. Rose and Ronald Bruno 8 points each. In a losing effort for Police Sports Club, we had Fewani Foy with 28, Marlon Hillier 11, and Sheldon Vidal 8. On the local cricket scene, we can tell you that Galleon Hurricanes defeated Marino Evergreen by 125 runs in action from the Dominica Cricket Association League on the weekend. Hurricanes took first knock and posted 237 all out in 28 overs. Adrian Matthews, 66, Limron Bernard, 43, and Marshall Gregoire, 37, and Felix Etienne, 35. Steve Williams picked up 4 for 46. In reply, Evergreen were bowled out for 112 in 15.1 overs, Bogart Green, 44, and Steve Williams, 20. Shem Matthew took 4 for 24 in 4 overs. Adrian Matthew was the man of the match. Meantime, Police Sports Club took a 3-0 win so far when they defeated Reuben Bakery Christians by 7 wickets on Saturday. Christians, first at the crease, scored 105 all-out in 22.2 overs. Alron Christopher, 39 not out, and Rick James, 20. Bowling for Police, Gavin James, 6 for 43. In reply, Police made 109 for 3 in 9.4 overs. Albert George, 41 not out, and Brian Felix, 32. Print Express Man of the Match award went to Gavin James. Meanwhile, in the two-day trial match, the Jelani Robinson 11 batted first and scored 267 for 9. Lex Maglore, 58, Dion Burton, 56, Vincent Luis, 50, Brian Joseph, 44, and Casimir Benjamin, 40. Daniel Dupini picked up 3 for 8 and Jassion Alexander, 3 for 44. In reply, Koshaski John Lewis, 11, were bowled out for 250. Taj Tavernier scored 56. Alvinson Jolly, 52. And Daniel Dupini, 44. Kasim Peltier picked up 4 for 42. Batting a second time, Jonali Robinson, 11, declared on 122 for 5. Dion Burton scored 30 and Jonali Robinson, 22. Set 122 to win, the Kershaski John Lewis 11 were 109 for 1 at stumps. Kaylee Kaby scored 58 and Sherlon George, 54. In football, defending champions New India Goodwill Runners dropped another 2 points as action continued in the Dominica Football Association's Dominic Women's League over the weekend.
On Saturday, we a New Generation Sports Club won by default over Bomber Starlights at the Stock Farm Complex. On Sunday, defending champions New India Goodwill Runners and the Mao Suka Strikers split to a nil-nil draw at the Stock Farm Complex. Cassandra Del Sol was named player of the match. While at the Benjamin Park, Dive Dominica Harlem United hammered West Coast Jaguars 10-0. Jada Serra registered a hat-trick with Ali Jatit, Kimara Sabroch and Kiana Francis each scoring 2. Tanji Ambo scored 1. Jada Serra was voted player of the match.
Next up, president of the Dominica Amateur Volleyball Association, Albert Loblack, feels that despite having a successful league and fielding teams at the under-23 indoor and youth beach tournaments, there was a lot left to be desired in relation to implementation and execution of the former executive's planned programs. Those comments at Saturday's annual general meeting of the executive body. Another area of concern coming out of the AGM was the penalty for teams who forfeited matches in the previous season and ensuring a smooth league moving forward. Meantime, after the election process, Albert Loblack was retained as president unopposed, as well as Ronald Joseph as treasurer, Erickson Liebler as vice president, and Marcus Blundell in the post of secretary. Former secretary Yvette Lynn Dura was re-elected, but to the position of assistant secretary treasurer, and Shari Pascal Maroney was elected as PRO. Finally, in netball, there were wins for New India Assurance Celtics, Under 23, and Northern Constructors Limited Portsmouth Secondary in action from the Big Edge Netball League over the weekend. On Sunday, the Under 23 team beat Spartans 39-35. For Under 23, we had Kyla Winston, 25 of 42, and Phoebisha Joseph, 14 of 24. In a losing effort, Anne Maria Xavier netted 23 of 28 for Spartans, while Melissa Williams added 12 of 17. In another match, New India Assurance Celtics got the better of Royal Garments PSS with a 34-12 victory. Scoring for Celtics, we had Verd Fontin, 27 of 31, and Kyle Winston, 7 of 13. For RGPSS, Shakira Bruno, 5 of 16, and Narella St. Jean, 2 of 13. Finally, Northern Contractors Limited Portsmouth Secondary bested Cocotown Cafe Portsmouth Secondary School 17-5. For NCLPSS, Selena Langley, 14 of 17, and Danita George, 3 of 5. For CTCPSS, Denise George, 2 of 4. That's all the sporting highlights for now. Join us next time. We check in now with the Met Office for the latest weather update.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's weather broadcast. I am your presenter, Annie Carrette Joseph. Moisture and instability continued to affect the central and northern portion of the region, with this area of deep convection seen over Hispaniola and Puerto Rico. Visible satellite imagery showed low-level clouds over Dominica during the course of the afternoon, and this resulted in mostly cloudy skies. Radar imagery indicated some scattered showers, mainly over the central portion of the Lesser Antilles. Conditions for tonight, partly cloudy to cloudy and occasionally breezy with some scattered showers. These weather conditions is expected to continue into tomorrow, and temperatures are expected to peak near 30 degrees Celsius. Sea conditions, slight to moderate in open water, with waves up to 5 feet. Conditions for Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, mostly cloudy skies with scattered showers expected to continue throughout the week. Temperatures expected to peak up to 30 degrees on Tuesday and Wednesday, and down to 29 degrees Celsius on Thursday. Across the region tomorrow, mostly cloudy skies with scattered showers expected to continue to affect the northern and central portions of the island chain. However, some slight improvement in conditions can be expected over the extreme southern portion. On the international scene, cloudy skies with some rain in New York, partly cloudy skies in Miami, clear skies in London and in Beijing, and some thunderstorm in Caracas. The sun will rise tomorrow at 5:45 a.m. and set at 6:22 p.m. For up-to-date information, log on to our website at weather.gov.dm or call the weather hotline at 447-5555. Thank you for viewing and join us next time.
To end the news, the headlines again. Prime Minister Skerrit pledges to introduce changes to make the Citizenship by Investment program more competitive. A call for sustained commitment to achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and a Dominican pilot endorses plans for an international airport. Feel free to contact us at news@marpin2k4.com. You can also access our past newscasts on our YouTube channel. On behalf of the entire production team, I am Kenny Williams. To our viewers around the world, thank you for watching. Join us next time.